everyone, welcome to the show. We are communicating every day in our life. But what is communication? What calls for an effective communication? Today we have with us Ms. Moina Sen, who is an eminent media person and academician. You have with you me, Sadaf Rizwan, and we also have...
Hi, I'm Amartya.
So ma'am, what is communication?
In the wider context, it is a human relationship, basically. Every human being has to be a social person. He is a social being. So communication is something when two human beings are together and they communicate. But the concept of communication obviously extends to a wider arena when we are talking about interaction, interchange, transactions, dialogue, sharing, communion, and commonness, which are ideas which crop up when we talk about communication. And communication in the larger context could be in the professional world, in the political world, in meetings, in processions, in any kind of communion basically between two people. Interestingly, the word is derived from the Latin noun, which is communis, and the Latin verb, which is communicare. So these two form make the meaning of being a common thing, a common place of action. So communication comes from there. It's the exchange and the flow of information and ideas from one person to another. So what it involves is a sender. That is, when I am talking to you, I am the sender and you are the receiver. So I am sending you the idea and you are receiving the idea. So that is when we talk about effective communication, when the sender is exactly getting the information that I am trying to transmit. We talk about the encoding and the decoding processes, which is when I am sending you the signal, it is the encoding one. And when you are getting the signal and transmitting it, it is the decoded one. Communication is something which creates, and it has to share a meaningful thing between two people. I mean, I cannot communicate something which does not mean anything to you. Unless it makes any sense to you, you will not be able to respond to me.
So basically, it is the exchange of ideas.
Right. What is the communication process? Like I told you, the decoding and encoding, but the first thing is the thought, which is the original concept which arises in my mind. Unless I have something to tell you or you have something to tell me, the communication cannot begin in the first place. So that is the beginning of communication. And then comes the encoding, where the message is sent to a receiver in a word or symbols. So when we are talking, it is verb, that is verbal. When we are not talking, it is non-verbal, so it is symbols. And then the decoding, when the receiver is translating the word or the symbols into a language that he understands. Now, after the person has decoded it and understood it, he gives a feedback. Now, this feedback is what? Something like an answer. So then the person who has sent you the message understands that you have received it. So unless there is a proper feedback, the communication is also not effective. We have something called a content, which is the actual words or symbols, that is known as the language, and the context, which we understand is the non-verbal elements. Like it could be, maybe I'm trying to say something to you, but I'm actually not using language and I'm using gestures. Or there is something about in my body language, which is telling you that I'm not liking this, or I'm not happy with this, or I'm actually very happy, or I'm very sad. So that is also communication, but I'm not using language. You're getting it from the context of the situation. So that is communication via context. What a lot of people say is that there is actually complete breakdown in a professional or a business or a corporate office when this linking is not happening. You know, this feedback is not taking place, which is why communication, when it is a dynamic process, and this dynamicism, when it breaks down, then there is a lack of communication. When there is a lack of communication, it can lead to a lot of misunderstandings. It can lead to actually the downfall, and it can lead to a lot of loss in business and in the professional or in the political world, and of course in relationships. That is happening all the time. When communications break down, relationships also finish.
Ma'am, are you in some way trying to say that whenever there is a hierarchy, when there is a top-down flow of communication, it always is unsuccessful?
Yeah.
So if there is a flow of message coming from the boss, which percolates maybe to the next level of staff, and so wise, and it might not always be that the people at the grassroots level are getting to communicate back. Do you believe that
Absolutely.
It will always lead to a breakdown?
When the effective, the encoding and the decoding are happening at the successful level, it will not. But say the boss, as you mentioned, just comes to his subordinate and says that, maybe he makes a sentence like, Ravi, I want you to do this work tomorrow. Now, Ravi does not even understand which work he is referring to. But he is so scared of the boss, he doesn't answer or he doesn't even ask back. Now, what has happening? Ravi has not understood. Ravi does not get the work done. So, maybe it was an important contract worth ₹1 million or something like that, which actually gets delayed. So, the entire breakdown of communication, like you are saying hierarchy, but this is just a hierarchical problem, but this is lack of communication because whoever sent the message did not wait for a feedback.
What are the barriers of communication?
There are certain factors which actually stop the communication in getting through. One of these is there is a bias, which is the cultural and the background bias. So the moment we understand that this person is not from my background, I will not respond to way that I will respond to a person who is close to my cultural or social or...
So the inherent prejudices that we
find. The inherent prejudices, exactly. Another second point is the noise. Now, if I'm talking to you and there is a lot of noise, maybe the TV is on or the radio is on or it's in a crowded place, then you're not getting my message. So that's again another barrier.
The competing stimulus.
Yeah, exactly. So that is noise. Another thing that people say is ourselves, which I think is a very interesting concept. Some people are very immersed in themselves. You know, they are always thinking about themselves. Even when they are talking to other people, it is really much more themselves than the other person. So they are not listening to that person very carefully. Even when the other person is talking, he's actually thinking about himself.
Or they are listening only what they want to listen.
Absolutely. So they are probably just listening to themselves. So there the communication is definitely not happening. So that is ourselves. Again, perception. We have these preconceived notions. You know what is preconceived notions like? We think that the person... Oh, if he looks like that, then he must be like that, which doesn't always happen. Maybe he doesn't look like a very educated person, but the moment he talks, he's a very educated person, right? But we don't give him that opportunity. So then again, communication break up. So that's barrier of communication. Another thing which happens is a message, which is distractions happen when we focus on the facts rather than the idea being communicated. In the sense that sometimes the language doesn't say so much that the concept in the language says. Are you understanding what I'm saying?
That it's more about the feel of the entire thing.
The feel of the... Probably it is an entire project that he's talking about, which cannot be put into 2-3 lines, you know. So if I'm just listening to those 2-3 lines, then I will not get the message. I should think about the bigger picture. Another is environmental, which is bright lights, or say if a film star is talking, you are mostly looking at what she's wearing and, you know, what kind of clothes she's wearing and what kind of makeup and jewelry, and you're not really listening to what she's saying. Maybe she's actually making sense, but you're not listening. So that's environmental. And the other is smothering, which is we like preconceived notions. Some things we just take for granted. Like if we listen to Narendra Modi today, we just know what he's going to say, but actually maybe he's talking something else. He's probably talking about some business statistics. So again, we are not giving him the chance to speak because we have already thought. And another is stress. We are constantly under stress, so we don't always react to situations the way we would. That also kind of breaks up communication. according to the pundits who have kind of dealt with communication and researched on it, they think there are some, a few, six or seven types of communication. One is the intrapersonal communication. What do you understand by intrapersonal communication?
So if I'm thinking, maybe I'm thinking aloud, or maybe I'm thinking deeply about something. I'm
talking to myself. Communication within oneself.
Okay, yes, exactly. So intrapersonal is within oneself. When we are also actually talking to ourselves all the time. So that is intrapersonal. So then you would know what is interpersonal, right? What is interpersonal?
Between two individuals.
Yeah, exactly. So that is interpersonal. That's communication. Group communication would be between groups. That's very simple.
Between two or many people.
Between two or many people, or it could be two groups. Okay. Or say three groups when conferences take place. Two or three people are actually representing a corporation or a corporate body or something, and they are actually forming groups and talking within themselves. So that's also group discussions, what we call group formation. So that's group communication.
So this is largely based on the number of people interacting with each other. The types of communication that you have defined so far, interpersonal, intrapersonal, group.
Do you think it's just the number of people, or is it also the kind of communication?
The kind of exchange.
I think the nature is also different. How can intrapersonal be the same as interpersonal?
No, but then interpersonal and group communication.
Yeah.
The feedback might be a little different.
Yeah.
The dynamic nature of it.
Totally. The scenario is different. So, you know, the responses will be different. But at the basic level, it is communication, as what you are saying.
Is the effectiveness also same? Do you perceive the effectiveness of these three communications to be the same as well?
If a group communication is well organized, then it could be effective.
If it's a focus group, sort
of
a discussion.
Yes. Now, if everybody is talking together, that kind of a group, then obviously it is not effective. Okay. Then I was talking about the verbal and the non-verbal. I mentioned to you before, like, verbal is obviously when you're using words and language. And non-verbal is, there are certain sub-classifications of non-verbal, which could be facial behavior and body movements, postures or gestures. And we, like, even when I'm talking, I'm using a lot of my hands. So that is kind of very common to human beings. They use a lot of these body movements. So postures and gestures, personal appearances, clothing, and distances between people as they interact. So it is the proximity that they are talking about. Like, how close you are to me. Obviously, when I'm sitting here and talking to you, I'll make more sense because you will give me your full attention. Other than if you're in the next room, you will not be able to hear me properly. So that's proximity.
Does it also denote somewhere the comfort level between the sender and the receiver, the distance between the individuals?
You could read it like that. But in a non-verbal setter, communication, I guess the distance is very important because you're not using words.
Right.
So if you are really far from each other, then more than the comfort, it has to be
about the effectiveness of the communication.
Yes, the effectiveness of the communication.
Ma'am, so how do you define the functions of communication? Like,
The function is slightly different in the sense that the main function, what would you think would be the main function of communication?
Maybe
what, according to you, would be the main function?
Exchange of ideas. So, sharing information, sharing knowledge.
Yeah. So, what is it doing?
It's sharing ideas.
Okay. But it is informing.
Informing.
Right?
Yes.
It is informing. So, the communication is informing. It is educated. It is entertaining, definitely, and also persuading people. Why are they persuading people? Why does it persuade people?
Because I'm trying to hammer my idea into another individual.
Right. So that is persuading people. Subgroups would be something like education and instruction. Information. Now, I think the communication, the biggest thing about communication is that information. We are actually informing people. Entertainment, of course, when we discuss mass media and when we discuss other things, entertainment is very big. And discussion, persuasion, cultural promotion, and integration. Now, integration is a communication that a large number of people across countries come to know each other, others' way of life. Because we communicate with them, it is bringing our cultures close to each other. So that is called integration, basically.
There is a criticism which is there that what media has done is it has killed the indigenous culture. Do you believe in that? That it has somewhere down the line brought a global culture and spoiled indigenous cultures?
No, I don't think so.
So you I really don't think it promotes indigenous culture equally?
Definitely, definitely. Because especially media and something, media like television, which goes into the remote villages now, you know, they are much more interested in what is happening next door really. They couldn't be bothered about what is happening in the country. They couldn't be bothered about what is happening in the next country, absolutely. But even they are being forced to see it, right? Because it's a moving picture and they are fascinated. So even when they see, sit down and see what is happening in and around their country, they are definitely getting to know more. So it is definitely communication, and they are getting to know much more about the country, which otherwise they will not get to know.
And then you also talked about information and entertainment separately.
Yeah.
There is this current trend, or as you might say, a little criticism. There is this thing called maybe infotainment.
Yes.
How do you see that trend coming in? Because information and entertainment somewhere down the line is coming together. And how do you think it has brought about a change? What are the positive sides and what are the negative sides?
That is the mantra of the age, infotainment. And we cannot stay away from that. And that is definitely also the future. Younger generation, the Gen X that we call, they are not so much into reading. That's what I find. They don't like to read books the way we used to, because we didn't have so much of option at our time. So we were much more into books. They don't. So they are, you know, all the time on the internet, or they are going into blog sites, or they're tweeting or whatever. But through that, if they're getting the information as to what is happening around in the world, or they're getting the news, so it is good. So they are getting their entertainment, but they're also getting the information through it. They're also being briefed and they're getting the thing. So infotainment is something that we can just not be casual about. And it is growing by the minute.
Do you somewhere down the line feel that it's true that information coming in the form of entertainment, mixed maybe with entertainment, is good? Do you somewhere see trivialization of important and serious news stories happening because of the hype that has to be generated with each story these days, and especially in news channels, 24/7 news channels more specifically?
Yeah, that happens. That of course happens, because it's catering to the masses.
So how do you see that? Because you've seen a wide range of time, like you've seen it evolve.
But there are other channels which cater to the serious audience. So again, when we have some 150 channels to watch, and people can just have a remote and sit with it, they can select their own channels and watch it. But this is a very big debate, whether news is being trivialized, and there are so many pros and there are so many cons. So that's a huge discussion, actually.
Right. And but when you talk about the information function of communication in general, and when you talk about how there are different channels, say for news only, the other person can simply switch over to another channel. Do you believe somewhere it leads to ambiguity? Because today we get to see that one particular channel has a different story to tell. Every single incident is told in 3-4 ways. So do you feel it leads to ambiguity, or do you think it leads to more options and more clarity in the process?
Not clarity, but this is the thing about free media.
If you have to like comprehensively conclude in a certain way of what the basics of communication are all about,
yeah,
how would you do that? I mean, especially keeping in mind the present trends of communication, how do you sum it all up? How do you sum the basics?
I would say effective communication would boil down to something like when a message is getting across. Now, it could be education, it could be entertainment, it could be hard news. So, effective communication for me would be something which is getting across to the right kind of people. And in the process, there is benefit on both the sides. I mean, if the sender is benefiting from it, and also the person who is decoding the signals is also benefiting from it, only then can a society be, you know, flourishing. Because if there is a confusion in the communication, then nobody is really aware of what is happening. which happens to a lot. It's not that that is just because it is the ideal situation, it is happening all the time. There are a lot of times when we don't know what a channel is trying to say and we don't agree with it. But then again, we have so much to select from. So communication, effective communication is successful communication.
So in the plurality of things, you don't see propaganda winning in any particular way. You see the plurality of message coming to the audience and how the audience has become more
propaganda
important.
Will be there also. Propaganda is a part of our life. So, but we have to be skillful enough to kind of sift through the propaganda and find out the real message. Not everybody can do it, but the effort is on, and if you are getting educated, you should be able to do it.
But looking at the overall picture, you feel that the audience is much more important today than it was maybe a few years back.
Definitely, because they are much more aware. I mean, when a film is not doing well at the box office with all the effort that is being put into it, the audience cannot be fooled really. They are actually rejecting a film, and they do it with everything that has been put in. I mean, the director thinks, I've done everything that I could, but the audience is still rejecting it. So it just, the audience is evolving in
big ways.
But then
at times you have critics writing off a film and the film does brilliantly well. Chennai Express was one such example.
Because a critic is just one person.
Yeah, the critics wrote off.
Critic is just one person.
Saying don't watch the film.
Yeah,
yes, true.
Absolutely.
So the audience is the key.
Yeah, definitely. So I would definitely go by the wider audience, and I would go for communication in the bigger sense, not just in the narrow context.
Not just in the narrow context.
Yes, absolutely.
And thank you so much for giving us the details of communication.
Thank you for
being
with
me.
Thank you.